live and out loud. There's examples of poems. There's multiple choice questions and review. There's tips on how to take a practice test. There's a Q&A with Heather, who is an AP Lit reader. That's all available for you. We also have our study guide available, which is really useful. The study guide pack, it's 28 pages. It's more than you need. I want to take you to the end of the study guide pack to a really important place to go. And that's, it's right around, sorry, I'm going to take us all the way down. Right here, we've got a whole section on multiple choice strategies that Heather, you're going to review for us, how to think through each step of the poetry analysis essay. People in the chat are like, I can't read poems. I've never seen a poem. What's going on? You can read poems. There is a plan for this. And the final thing I wanted to point out to you all, and this is just super cool. We'll put this in the chat. It's in the description of this video, is our free online events page where we took all the live reviews from AP Biopenguins and the Garden of English and Marco Learning and Steve Heimler and Antisocial Studies and Tom Ritchie. We put it in one giant place for you. So definitely check this out as you're going through this AP season. We've got it all available for you on the free events page. So Heather, I'm going to turn it over to you really quickly. What are we going to be focusing on for the exam tomorrow?
Oh my gosh, guys, it is tomorrow. I hope you are just as thrilled as I am. So we are going to be talking about some general test taking strategies, then I'm going to narrow it into multiple choice, and then I'm going to narrow it into the essays. And I had some slides at the end highlighting some of my favorite Marco videos, but John just did it for me. So we're going to take those right out of there. So let me go ahead and share my screen. And I am so excited to get started. So what is the goal of today? Like, why are we here? What is your goal for tomorrow? I need you to do your best on the AP literature exam, not your study partner's best, not your best friend's best, your best, because tonight is not the night to start laying on all the pressure. Tonight is the night to listen and feel like you are fully confident and ready to go into this and live up to your potential on this test, right? This is not the time to panic. This is not AP Chem. This is not AP Gov. This isn't like we need to cram all the information. This is just refreshing the things you've been practicing all year. So let's look at some test taking tips just as an overview. Regardless of whether you are in the multiple choice section or you are in the essay section, I am going to need you to read that text carefully, whatever it is that you're looking at, because this test is designed to test your comprehension. It is essentially just a big old comprehension test. And if you panic and you go too fast, you're going to miss some of those important details. And we certainly don't want that. So don't read slowly, but read carefully, read thoughtfully. This is not the time to start picturing your dorm room and like picking out colors on like for your bedding. No, that is not what this is. This is you paying attention. Take some quick notes. The joy of this AP test is that you can annotate. You're going to have paper, you're going to have a pencil, you're going to have a pen when you're doing the essay portions, and you can underline, you can circle, you can put stars. If you're finding a symbol, put a big old S beside it and keep going. That will help you remember where some of those important details are. Do you need to write words? I don't know, maybe, but I think that just interacting with the text, first of all, is going to keep you accountable, right? Like I am in this, right? I'm going to underline, I'm a circle and I'm a star, but it's also going to give you points to go back to so that you have some quick references. So what do you look for? What are some of the things that you should be noting as you're reading? Well, the first thing I always like to look for is the tone, because if it is, let's say it's a poetry multiple choice, and it's about death, I should not have a lot of lovey-dovey language. If the tone of this is super optimistic, is it really about death? Or does this person just have a really optimistic outlook on death? Right? I need to be able to see that. And then maybe, is there any big metaphors happening? So like Robert Frost's poem, Apple Picking, the whole thing is a big old metaphor for death. But if you think it's just about him out there picking apples and having too many apples to pick, you're missing the metaphor of him and all of those missed opportunities, right? So you got to always think like College Board is not picking me a poem about apple picking without there being a bigger metaphor. There's always a bigger one. What's the theme, right? If you can try to wrap up what is the point that this author is trying to give me, then you're going to be in a much better place to understand what's happening in the text. figure out who's speaking and to whom they are speaking. Like, this feels like a very basic thing, but if you are stuck in a passage, sometimes just wrapping your head around this can kind of recenter you, especially if you get yourself into like one of those panic modes. How is the author achieving his or her tone? That would be a great thing to underline, circle star. And then, are there any big shifts, especially in poetry, especially if there's a sonnet? I can tell you that if there is a shift in tone or a shift in perspective, or I think all of these things except these, right? Anytime you get those but, except, however, that shift is for sure going to end up being a question or being something important you should note. I usually draw lines where the shifts are. You might want to be familiar with just the basic literary terms, right? So if you have gotten to this point in AP Lit and we're struggling with metaphor, simile, irony, and symbolism, I think that maybe just a quick refresher might be good. Go to our study guide. It is all in there. But honestly, those are really just kind of the four that you need. I don't think you need to worry about the difference between like metonymy and synecdoche. Like, you're good, honestly. Metaphor, simile, irony, symbolism, then get you through the whole test. Do not panic. Managing your time, right? You have a 3-hour test. Now, part of that's going to be managed for you, right? You're going to walk in, you're going to have that multiple choice section first, then you'll have a little break, and then you're going to have to really manage your time for those 3 essays that come next. So, and this has to do with being familiar with the testing format. So let's jump straight ahead and let's just look at this exam format for just a minute. I am so certain that you know this testing format by now, but on the off chance that you are not taking an AP Lit test and you're just in a senior English and your teacher's like, hey, guess what? You're taking the AP Lit test tomorrow. And you're like, oh, okay, great. Let's look at what you're in for. 1 hour, 55 questions for a multiple choice section, about 5-ish passages, 45% of your total score. So that could be poetry, could be excerpts from drama, excerpts from novels, short stories. They're going to be relatively short, 10, 12, 15 questions each, just kind of depends on the makeup of the test. You should give yourself about a minute per question, and that includes the reading. So if you see that there are 15 minutes for the first passage and the first 12, 15 questions, just give yourself 15 minutes, right? And that includes the reading. It's a quick test. You're going to take your multiple choice and you get a little break, little break. Some school sites will let you step out and use the restroom. Some school sites kind of keep you sequestered during that hour, but you're not allowed to talk, not that hour, that break. Here's your goal for the break in between the multiple choice and the free response section. Get some water, get a mint or some gum. Get your body moving. I don't care if you're quietly doing jumping jacks in the corner, like get your body moving and try to get some sunshine if you can. Sunshine, that vitamin D is just going to rejuvenate you. We're just big old plants, right? We need water. We need sunlight. We need rest, all the things. And then you dive into your free response section when you come back. You have your favorite pens with you, multiple of them, right? Because we don't want to be stuck using the 10-cent Bic ones unless those are your favorites. 55% of your total score is going to come from these next 3 essays. So if you were going to equally distribute, you'd spend 40 minutes on poetry, 40 minutes on prose, 40 minutes on the literary argument. I will tell you, sometimes the prose passages get a little lengthy and sometimes poems are a little shorter. So maybe adjust your times as appropriate. And you don't have to write in the order that they present the questions to you. So if you wanted to start with question 3 with a literary argument essay because you have a novel fresh in your head, go for it. Start with your strength. Because what you don't want to happen is you really belabor the poetry and the prose and you only leave yourself for 20 minutes of literary argument, but you have the best book with the best idea and the prompt, it all aligns beautifully and you don't get to finish it. Right? So we want to make sure that we're really timing those out well and start with your strengths. Do not be afraid to go out of order on that section. And then stay focused because, oh my goodness, if you get like the gum chewer on the other side of the room and they're like chomping or people are like running to the bathroom. I had 1 year as a proctor where one of my co-proctors had clicky heels and I went over and politely demanded that she take them off. And then she walked around in her stocking feet the rest of the day. But you know what? Like sometimes you just have to advocate, but try to stay focused. If you know that you are a kid who's super easily distracted, maybe bring some earplugs, like the kind that come in the little package, like bright orange ones, but talk to your proctor first, like ask permission. Like there's nothing that says you can't have them. You can't have earbuds. Big no to that, but really try to stay focused. Okay, answer all of the questions, every single question. I don't care if you only have a minute and a half left and you've got 10 questions you need to finish, pick a letter and roll with it. Because if you can make a guess, it's better than leaving it unanswered, because then you at least have, you know, 20% chance of getting it right. The AP Lit test is a test of reading comprehension and endurance. Try to stay relaxed. Take a deep breath. You have prepared for this test all year long. You have practiced the same skills over and over and over again with new texts. That's what this test is. It is a culmination of all of your practice, not trying to see if you can remember every single thing about everything you've read. That's not this. This is just going in and showing what you can do. And that is, it can be a really relaxing feeling knowing that you are just repeating the same old things that you've done. And that's great. So I'm going to, John, do we have any questions in the chat before I move into multiple choice? I don't want to neglect anybody.
Hey everyone, it's John from Marker Learning. We do have some questions in the chat, but most of them are about multiple choice tips. So this is going to be a great opportunity, everyone, to look at, you know, how you're going through this tomorrow. Heather, I just want to repeat one thing that you said that's so important, which is we're telling all of you to trust your own voice and your own experience. You don't need to read 5 books tonight. You're not going to transform your life and your score. You're going to focus on what you're capable of doing. And you're not going to leave 11 questions blank. And you're not going to panic when you read a difficult passage. Maybe it's a little bit tricky. You're going to power through this. So Heather, I'm really dying to hear about your tips for students taking the AP Lit exam tomorrow.
So multiple choice, I think, is going to be the area that most students are nervous about. So what if you don't understand a passage? Like you dive in and you're like, I have no idea what this is about. Look for a metaphor, right? See if you can figure that out. But honestly, here's what I'm going to tell you to do. Go to the last question for that question set. So let's say there are 14 questions attached to this poem. You have no idea what this poem's about. Read that final question in the passage set, because here's what AP will always do, or at least they have done consistently for the past however many years. They put a question at the end of each set that is a culminating question that talks about the poem as a whole or the passage as a whole. And it's going to be something along the lines of tone or author's purpose or something like that. If you can look at that question and you see that it's asking you which of the following lines gives you the best thematic evidence that this poem is about love. Well, okay, now thank you for that. The poem's about love. Now, okay, let me dive back into the poem and look at it through that lens. That doesn't work with every question, right? But that final question can usually give you a pretty good hint. And then if that fails you, right, just know that College Board is not going to give you a poem about a wishing well and have it be just about a wishing well. There's always going to be some bigger meaning. You got to find it. Just look for it. Just know that it's never what it seems like on the surface. When you are looking at the multiple choice questions, really pay attention to the literary devices as they show up. So if you are reading and you notice a simile, underline it. You notice a metaphor, underline it. You notice symbolism, circle it. They may not ever ask you questions about those things, but if they do, or if that simile, metaphor, imagery, symbolism, if those things can lead you to the meaning of the text, you're already kind of in the gold, right? Identifying them as you read just kind of sets you up for answering those questions. And if you are the type of test taker who can look at the question stems before you read, kudos. Go do that and then go back to your multiple choice passage and read the passage. That is not a strategy for everybody. If you have not been practicing by looking at the questions first and then diving back into the passage and reading the passage, don't start tomorrow. Like tomorrow is not the day to pull out new tricks. Tomorrow is the day to do whatever it is that you have been doing in your multiple choice and just kind of jazzing it up a little bit with a few strategies here and there. Don't change the whole way you try to test. Don't do that. Pay attention to the tone and style. Remember that when you are paying attention to the author's use of language, You're looking at how it contributes to the overall style. And if you can read by keeping that in mind, what is the tone? What is the style? The multiple choice questions are going to just be that much easier to answer. And please keep track of your time. After every passage, right? Every passage set, 14, 15, however many questions you get, look at the clock, because you will be so surprised how quickly 20 minutes will slip away from you when you were only supposed to have spent 15. And what you don't want to happen is you get to the point where the proctor calls 10 minutes and you still have half of the test left for multiple choice. Just after each passage set, check your time and adjust accordingly. And then please, please, please use the process of elimination, because you're gonna have 5 answer options that you can pick from. 3 of them are going to be wrong for various reasons. And those reasons are listed in the multiple choice handout in the study guide pack that John showed you earlier. 3 of the answers are going to be wrong. Literally cross them out on your test paper, not bubble sheet, your test paper. And then you're usually left with 2. One's going to be a good answer. One's going to be better. The goal is to pick the better one. But if you can at least get the answer choices down to 2, you're giving yourself a 50-50 chance of getting it right, even if you have to guess. And that is fantastic, right? We don't want a 20% chance. That's not the goal. Here are a couple of other tips. Do not let a test question rattle you. This isn't a 100% kind of test. This isn't the kind of test where you can walk in having prepared and memorize an entire test prep book, and you have all these formulas in your head, or you have all of these names and dates, and you can spit them out and you can get 100%. That's not this. This test is one that you cannot prepare for. You have no idea what passage is going to be given to you, no idea who the authors are, the time periods, the political climate during which it was written. You don't know any of that. So if you walk into this test and you're getting 65% of the test questions right, 70% of the questions right, 80%, like, that is winning the game. Do not let this test freak you out because you're not getting all of them right, or you're feeling uncomfortable with a couple of questions in each passage. That's okay, because you know what? These questions are all weighted equally. It's not like any one question is weighted heavier than the others. So that means don't sit there for 7 minutes on one question, sweating it out. You move on, flag it on your paper. Think, if, you know, I got a few minutes, I'll come back to this one. Make sure that you're bubbling, right? Like, you're on question 12, make sure that your bubble's on question 12, right? You got to keep that tight. But don't let one question throw you. And read the questions first, only if that is a strategy that you have practiced in the past. If you have not, please don't start tomorrow. Can't stress that enough. Before I move on to essay writing, I know I am moving it like warp speed, my goodness. I would love to see if there's any other multiple choice questions from the chat that I have neglected to answer.
So Heather, we've got one interesting question about this, which is, how do we tell when you've got it down to 2 answer choices, right? Questions are different, passages are different. How do you tell what makes something feel right or seem right on the test versus something that's wrong? Are there any clues about what wrong
is? Yeah. If it's too literal, chances are it's not the right one, right? This goes back to AP never picking anything for its surface value. So one of the things that the test writers do is they gather up all of these excerpts and all of these questions, and then they send them out to colleges for field testing. So they have made very, very certain that all of these things are handled in advance and that all of them are test prepped. And I'm so sorry. I lost track. I ended up with a visitor. John, I need to be recentered.
Fine. We were just, and one thing actually, if I may too, Heather, is this whole issue of kind of getting it down to the last 2. I want to show you in this study guide, everyone, a really good page will help you all. So I want to show you, and I want to put this in the chat. In fact, Heather, if you can go ahead, stop sharing your screen.
So stop sharing.
And then everyone, I want to show you, this is on our website and we've got the link in the chat. When you go to free resources and you go to study guides, there's a really great answer to this in our AP English Lit study guide pack. Here it is, it's got an orange cover, and you scroll down to the multiple choice part, and we do map out some of those those very likely incorrect answers. So we get down to multiple choice, and here they are, what you were just saying. Answer choices that are too literal. So 100%. They copy something from the passage sort of verbatim in a way that isn't allowing for that room and that literary interpretation. Recycled language, where they copy words and phrases from the question to sort of trick you. Things that are halfway true, you're reading the choice and you're like, yeah, that's true. But then it sort of takes this turn where it's not true anymore. And then finally, watch words like always, never, must. Those are things that can really throw you off. So that's a great answer to that question. Now, Heather, one other thing that's coming up in this chat that's really important is I got 5,000 questions about the sophistication point. You and I both are like, okay, that's the wrong question for the night before the test. Why should we not focus any time in our session on the sophistication point?
Okay. The sophistication point is a unicorn, first of all. Not very many of them are distributed. I want to say like 18% of the kids get them. But it's not necessary to get a 5. Like if you are getting 65 to 75% of the questions right, and you are earning your thesis point, and you are earning 4s in your body paragraphs, and you are providing evidence, and you are backing up your claims, and giving really good commentary, and connecting it back to the thesis, you're getting a 5. Like you're fine. That sophistication point is there when, as a reader, I look at an essay and I'm just like, dang, or like, I learned something new reading this passage. This kid has a super cool take on this. That sophistication point isn't necessarily something that you can prep for the night before. There's no magic formula. There's no single thing someone can teach you. It comes from reading great books, having really great conversations, and writing a lot. And none of those things are going to happen tonight.
Exactly. I think that's why we're not going to really, we'll get into a little bit of kind of what to do in the free response questions. But Heather, I'm going to turn over to you to share your slides, kind of walk us through strategies we can use for free response questions.
Awesome. Okay, let me dive back in. All right, we're all seeing it. Perfect. Okay. There it is. As an AP Lit scorer, one of the things that I see often that I think students use as a crutch is pulling too many quotations. Students, particularly in the poetry and the prose, essay 1 and 2, really want to prove to the readers that they have read the passage and that they're going to pull. And they will spend, I can tell, minutes painstakingly copying over quotations from the passage, like multiple lines. Don't do that. Give yourself a limit. Maybe pick a number. 7 is my favorite. Like, don't quote more than 7 words in a row from the passage. First of all, it's taking too much time. And if you're pulling too many sentences, you're not hyper-focusing on whatever detail it is that you're trying to find. So if you have a full sentence, but you really only need to talk about these 3 words of it because these 3 words are significant, then just pull those 3 words, right? You don't need the whole thing. And you do not have to provide us line numbers for any of it, because I can promise you, by the time we get to your essay, we have read the source material so many times we know exactly where it is, like 100% know where it is. Also, keep in mind that these essays are drafts. As readers, we are 100% aware that your essays are drafts, and we are treating them as such. We don't expect drafts to have complete citations, ever. So you're fine just throwing in a couple of words, directing us to where you want us to be. You don't need to give us any plot summary to get us there. Like, trust us, we know where you are, okay? You also want to make sure that you have enough space and time within your essay to provide multiple supports for each claim that you make. So if you're trying to write about how, I don't know, this field is going to represent this person's growth, I don't know, I'm just making something up. You had better be able to give me a couple of different examples from throughout the passage to back up those supports. And you're going to want to make sure that you are elaborating and explaining to us why you have chosen the lines that you have and how they connect to your thesis. Don't assume that we're just going to follow your breadcrumbs. Like, you've got to spell it out for us. That's how you get that 4 in that row B, the evidence and commentary. There we go. What is the best way to make sure that you're not just summarizing what happens? Focus on the author. Authorial intent is the king for all three essays. If you find yourself talking more about the characters than about the author, you don't always run into plot summary, but it is a dangerous place to be, particularly with question 3. So if you are going to write about Beloved, and you are going to talk about Denver or Sethe or Beloved herself, and you are using those character names consistently, and you're not talking about Toni Morrison, I am worried that you are landing a little bit heavier into summary than you are into authorial intent, which can get you to analysis a lot faster. Tons of verbs. The author. So Toni Morrison explains, Toni Morrison symbolizes, Toni Morrison crafts. Like, give the author verbs that he or she is doing, and then tell us why he or she is doing those things, right? The author does this, pick a good verb, in order to do this, and what is the desired effect or purpose? That is how you keep it out of plot summary and into analysis, right? It's a pretty basic formula. You don't have to keep it that basic, but it'll definitely get you where you need to be. Some other suggestions for writing timed essays in general. Please do not rush through the prompt. You are going to have 3 different prompts that you need to address: the poetry, the prose, and the literary argument. Each one of those prompts deserve, and not just the passage, I'm talking like the actual prompt, deserve your attention and your annotation. Underline, circle, I like to number, like I'll do a 1 and circle it and a 2 and circle it so that I can make sure at the end of the essay that I have done all of the things that the prompt has asked me to do. Pay attention to the keywords and phrases. And if they're telling you to write about one character, please focus on one character. Do not think you can write about 6 or 3 or even 2. You get one, okay? Pay attention to those keywords and phrases. Follow directions. Now, I say that, but let's pretend like the only book you have read this year is Beloved. The only book you read. And you get a prompt where it doesn't fit. And you're like, oh, I don't know what to do now. And you panic. You can tweak the prompt a bit. So let's say the prompt is asking you about, there was one year about like pastoral fields and how these fields represented the characters. Well, you know what? There's no pastoral fields in Beloved, but what there are plantations. So you say, while there were no pastoral fields, plantations serve this purpose, and then off you go. Acknowledge the fact that you're deviating just a little bit and go with it. And then keep tying it back as often as you can and move on. The AP readers are way more interested in seeing you tackle through a hard prompt than caring if it's a pasture or a field. Like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Analyzing the text, particularly for the poetry and the prose, right? Again, look for those themes, those symbols, those motifs. Annotate your passage. Do not write commentary throughout the margins. This is not an assignment. No one's going to like give you a gold star if you have the most notes, but you are going to feel more confident going into your essay if you can very quickly circle, underline, star, and have some points that you can go back to. When it comes time to do the free writing, I'm just going to draw you, like, seriously. Ready? That is how I plan. My thesis, and this is right on my paper, literally my thesis goes right into that circle. I have 3 main ideas and I go. That's it. Because you don't have time for a ton more unless you've been practicing with your teacher and they have given you some super fantastic strategies, right? And you've been practicing and you know the timing and you for sure know that you can get out this amazing plan. Like, go for it. I'm not trying to undo any of the training you had. But this is usually enough to get me going, right? Keeps me focused. It has my thesis statement down and written out and ready to go, which is my next point. Before you go to your lined paper, you should have your thesis statement literally at the top of the paper that has the prompt and the passage on it, because it can get a little lost in the intro of your essay. You're not going to have a highlighter to highlight it. And you want to be able to look back at it quickly as you're writing in case you get lost. Because like you saw happened a minute ago, right? It's very easy to lose your train of thought when you get interrupted or distracted. And sometimes you need something to frame you. I had John, thank you, John, but you will have your thesis statement sitting at the top of your paper that you can look back at and be like, oh, right. And then off you go, right? Make certain your thesis is debatable. Make sure you can support it with evidence from the text. And when you are pulling examples for your text, and I'm specifically thinking about question 3, because that's the literary argument and you don't have anything really to quote from, you're going to want to pull super specific examples to support your argument. You're not going to want to say, when beloved haunts house 124. You're going to want to say, when that baby ghost shook that house to its foundation in its dramatic haunting, right? Like super specific examples, because then it's showing the reader, first of all, that you have done the deep dive, that you have really studied this work and you have some sort of connection to it, but it also gives you more to talk about and spring from, because now I have details that I can pull from and elaborate. And then of course, making sure that you have more than one piece of evidence to back up your claims. When, I'm glad you guys were asking about the sophistication point, because one of the ways that you can work yourself towards sophistication is if you consider different interpretations of the text, particularly with questions 1 and 2, the essay and the prose, because you're going to get a poem that you've probably never seen and a passage that you've probably never seen, or an excerpt. And you are going to read those and consider, well, if I read it this way, it means this, but if I read it this way, it means this. And if you could find a way to work both of those into your essay, that is one of the components for sophistication. And if you find that as you're thinking about it, one way seems a lot stronger than the other, you can always like abandon the other and just keep focusing on the one. But it just strengthens your argument and helps that you, it helps demonstrate that you have an understanding of the text. I wouldn't necessarily do this for question 3. Unless you have already, because that's a longer work, like it's hard to just randomly pull a second interpretation. But if you, in the course of your studies with your teacher, you have multiple interpretations that could work. I'm thinking of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, because for that text, you can read it from the lens of class dichotomies and look at it from a really class and financial station perspective. Or you can look at it from a psychology perspective with like the id, the ego, and the superego from Sigmund Freud, if you are super AP psych nerdy like me. Or you could take it from a historical perspective and how repressed people were during the Victorian society. Or like you, there's so many ways you can look at it as drug addiction. Like I got 4 right there. And that's just Jekyll and Hyde. So the more lenses you can approach something with, the better. And it's literary theory, but it works. Organizing your essay, you should try to have a super clear structure. And like legit, this is my structure. It is super easy. What I do not do is I do not have a paragraph about similes, a paragraph about metaphors, and a paragraph about symbolism. I don't do that. I try to find themes I can talk about that connect to the prompt. And I do different themes for each of those little branches. And then within there, I might talk about symbolism and metaphors and similes and all of that, but like seriously, the themes are the focus. Use topic sentences, use transitions, all of your good writing skills, right? This is your chance to shine, because as much as this is a comprehension assessment, it is also a writing assessment. Think about the purpose of taking this particular AP class. You are trying to get yourself out of Comp 1 and 2, right? Well, that's the goal. Comp 1, get out of there with AP Lang. Comp 2, get out of there with AP Lit. That's the goal. You have to prove to the readers that you can write just as coherently as you can read, right? Something to keep in mind. And along those lines, we know as AP readers that this is a draft, 100%. And you're writing in pen. Like, trust me, we get it. But if as you are writing, you could take time to capitalize your letters, pop in those periods, maybe fix, I say typos in here, but obviously it's not typos if you are writing, but going back in those little things that we accidentally make mistakes on if we don't mean to, go ahead and proofread the best that you can before you turn in that final thing and you have to submit and the, they call time, right? And then managing your time, right? It's 55% of that overall essay and you only have the 2 hours. So we've already talked about this, but try to leave yourself time to proofread. Here's something that's really nice about the handwritten essay. AP readers are trained to follow your breadcrumbs. What I mean by that is, let's say you leave yourself 5 minutes at the end of the entire test and you go back to your weakest essay and you want to bolster it up a little bit. And you're like crossing things out and fixing things and you are drawing arrows in the margin, or you're like, oh, I really want to insert this sentence here. So you write it at the bottom of the page and draw an arrow up to where it belongs. We will follow your breadcrumbs when we are reading. We will get to that line and we'll see the arrow. We will go down and read your sentence and then we will come right back up and keep reading. Like, we will follow you in all of your messy glory. So when I say go back and proofread your essays, I don't just mean make sure your commas are in the right place. I mean, make sure that you explained that point well enough. Make sure that you connected it back to your topic sentence or your thesis. Make sure that you are proving to me that the writing you are doing is your best. So what needs to be in your essays, just kind of overall, overarching? I'm just checking my time, making sure I'm doing, keeping you in the lines. Did your introduction include a thesis that's defensible and focuses on the purpose that was given to you in the prompt, right? Doesn't matter which of the three essays you're on, it's all the same. Bring theme in early. Why? Because if you run out of time and I haven't gotten to the theme, at least I know you got it in there early, right? Bring it in early. Don't like wait to have some big drop at the end. Like, it's not the New Year's Eve. It's fine. You don't need a big drop at the end. Body paragraphs, 2 to 3 of them. Substance matters, right? Make them meaty. Give me lots of examples. Give me clear transitions. Smoothly integrate those quotations if you have practiced doing so. Ensure your commentary ties back to the purpose. Make 2 to 3 points in each paragraph. Here's what you need to know about closings. Ready? They're not on the rubric. Not even a little bit. There is no component of the rubric that says that you need to have a closing. Here's your job in the closing. Prove to me that you have a thesis statement. Because if for some reason in your introduction, it wasn't super great, like it wasn't perfect, now in your closing, you have an opportunity now to tie it back to the prompt again and take a different take on that thesis statement. Don't copy the same one, because if I didn't like it in the beginning, I'm not going to like it again. Don't copy it, but find a different way to rephrase it. And that's what your closing is for, just to make sure you're securing that thesis point. That's it. I went ahead and included in here some verbs that you can do if you're talking about authorial intent or author's purpose, right? Toni Morrison is demonstrating, she's juxtaposing these two characters, she's emphasizing this theme, she is supporting her point through this, right? So like, try to really pull on some of those verbs. And these are just a few of the verbs, there are tons that you could pull. Okay, questions about essay writing before I go into just some closing suggestions that are a little more general.
Yes, Heather. We've had some great conversations going on in the chat. Just as a couple of friendly reminders for people, vocabulary is not tested on this test. You should not study. Remember, Heather, the good old days of AP English Lit, right? When you had to like memorize all those literary devices, that era is over. So if you have some book from 6 years ago that's got all this stuff about like iambic pentameter and onomatopoeia and whatever, really not where to focus your attention. Instead, go to those study guides I was showing you earlier that will take you through different parts of the exam. And one other tip I want to give people are like, what books can I do? What book should I memorize? Bro, it's 8:39 Eastern, the night before the test. Get away from those very intensive and low yield kind of results and focus instead on the better thing that you should be doing, which is take one or two parts of the test, multiple choice, the Q3, and just drill right into those parts only. Sometimes less is more. You do better that way. And the other thing I'll say is, if you've got questions like, you know, I really need more on the multiple choice, or I really want more on that Q3 literary argument essay, then remember, we've got a playlist with about 50 videos that goes, there's short videos and long videos. There's ones where we go through sample problems. That's all available on our channel. And just about our channel, if you have not yet subscribed to it, go ahead and subscribe. And if you like this video, press that like button. Definitely stay with us in the chat. And you know what? I want to create good vibes in the chat. So I want the happiest emojis, because the people are scared. What happens? I'm going to put a heart in there, and I'm going to put smileys in there. I'm going to fill the chat with positive emojis and good vibes as we go into some of the suggestions, Heather, that you have. I'm curious, what are your best tips for how to spend tonight and how to think about this exam tomorrow?
Oh, are you ready? Go get in your comfiest pajamas and go to bed. A good night's sleep is absolutely the best thing you can do for yourself and staying hydrated. Your brain cannot think if it is shriveled up like a raisin or jacked up on caffeine in the morning. You need your highest executive functioning. Tonight, when you get out of this call, I want you to get comfy. I want you to curl up in bed. And I want you to just kind of shut down a little bit. And when you wake up in the morning, if you feel like you want to look over the study guides when you're fresh, you want to wake up a little bit early, you are not going to wear your comfiest pajamas to the test. You are going to dress for success. You are going to dress as if you are not giving a presentation, goodness, but like, you know, dress it up a little. Don't wear your pajamas. We don't want our body to think that we're too comfortable taking this test, right? But hydrate, get some sun in the morning, maybe take your study guide or your laptop outside, look at it on your tablet, right? Hydrate, rest, do it in the morning. That's my best suggestions. As far as, you know, like tonight goes, that's what I have. Okay. And John, like, oh, and eating a good breakfast. I can't believe I didn't say that. Tomorrow morning is not your pancake morning, right? You do not want tons of heavy sugars starting your morning, right? You want to make sure that you've got some fiber and some protein to kind of carry you through, and then toss a granola bar in your bag before you go so that you have it for in between those two tests. And then arriving early, particularly if you are unfamiliar with your testing site or your testing room, because chances are you're not going to be testing in the same room that you have class in. Maybe, I guess I shouldn't make that assumption, but arrive early. That way you don't have to worry about traffic or like some very ancient person holding up the line at, you know, like a drive-through place, like whatever. Just get there early, read your instructions carefully, listen as the proctor is giving the instructions, right? Budgeting your time, start with the easy questions. And ultimately, I want you to stay calm. This is your morning plan, looking at the AP Lit study guide, looking at the YouTube videos. Like, these are some of my favorites that John and I have done. See, this one's 40 minutes for poetry. Maybe that one you want to do tonight. This is our last minute review from 2021. I really enjoyed that one. This is John walking you through an entire poetry essay. I really enjoy this particular one. The prose fiction analysis, the literary argument. So how am I doing? It's 8:43 before I tell them to go to bed. Give me more questions.
Yeah. So actually, everyone, I want to turn it over to you in the chat. You've been a great group tonight. Really smart, focused, awesome questions. Please post those questions in the chat. You can actually start with the word question in all caps. And we're going to take some of these and spend the next 5 to 10 minutes here on Q&A with the reminder that you can comment on this video if you're watching the recording, and we'll try to answer before your test tomorrow. And that you can also reach out to us on social media. We're on Instagram and TikTok and all the good places. So real quick, we've got a couple questions here. And thank you, Maxwell, for the super chat. One question is, do you have any tips on identifying and relating literary elements and techniques back to the prompt and thesis? I've watched your essay videos, but I'm still having trouble. It's that moment, Heather, of like linking the literary devices back to your thesis. What's some of your general advice on this?
The best way to do it is to focus on theme. If you can work a theme into your thesis and that theme connects to the prompt, you may not always be able to connect it to like your thesis statement in general or the prompt in general, but you can always tie it back to theme. Like that's just an easy, that's a gimme.
Great. There's a question here about that 40 minutes, Heather. The 40 minutes between essays, as we go through the whole experience, are they going to tell us when the 40 minutes have passed on the test, or do you have to figure it out for yourself?
Oh, that is such a good question. Okay. In the script, they should tell you when your 40 minutes happen. I have had the experience with my own AP students where the proctor did not do as such. So it would be lovely if your proctor did that. And in between that break, you are welcome to ask the proctor to pace you out just as a reminder, like, hey, can you give us that heads up when we should be moving on to the next essay? Like, that's a perfectly legitimate question to ask during the break, not during the testing session. That'll just throw them. But as a fail safe, you should pace yourself too. Just keep an eye on the time, maybe on one of the prompts, like write down your start time and, you know, 40 minutes from then and when you think you should be moving on. But
great. So two quick questions I'm going to take here. Haley's got the question, is In Cold Blood considered an accredited book for the AP Lit exam?
There's no absolutely.
Yeah, there isn't an accredited kind of category anyway. And certainly Truman Capote is up there. Great, great kind of question overall. Don't second guess the books you're going to cite tomorrow, especially if you've prepped them, especially if your teacher has given you that recommendation. You're likely just fine. They really are open to doing this. And even the way some readers have said, it's sort of like, hey, if you're going to use Harry Potter, okay, that's a limiting choice. It's not the best choice that's there. We recommend going with the things that you've read in your AP Lit class, things that your teacher has signed off on. But you know, this gets to another question here from KL, which is about you said not to order your paragraph with by each literary device, but I've been practicing that all year. Should I
do it?
That's what I was gonna say.
Yes. Oh my gosh. If that is what you have been practicing, please do not try to change the entire way you write essays now. That is not my personal Heather method of writing. But if that is your KL version of like how you tackle your essays, please do that. Do not try to redesign an entire year worth of writing in a night. No. Yeah.
And this relates to a question last year. There's a sort of theme emerging around a lot of the questions we're getting in the chat tonight, which is this, the sort of like, I think a lot of you are kind of, you're shooting up here with these really big questions. Like, if I'm saying your name right, Lasya, you're saying, what do I do if on Q3, if none of the books I've read are applicable? Your book is probably is applicable, right?
Yes.
Like jam it in there, make it work with the prompt. The prompts are broad enough and the books that you're probably on your list are broad enough that make it work, even if it's not immediately obvious. Any other tips you'd give Heather on that sense of like, oh, I'm not sure if my book works on Q3.
So one of the things I have found is when you get to question three, if you have a particular book in mind or even two, write the characters' names down in the margins of your paper, because what our instinct is to go for that main character when we're approaching that question three prompt. But oftentimes one of the secondary characters is going to provide maybe a richer essay that we wouldn't have thought of right away. So just by listing the characters quickly, I swear it's such a silly thing, but just writing their name, you're like, oh, Denver. And then you can like off and running. So sometimes just having that is enough to launch you back into the prompt.
Yeah, and everyone, there's a question here, Heather, that just emerged about this digital AP exam. And I want to say something. I first met you, Heather, at the AP annual conference, and you were talking about annotation and you had students scribbling in the margins. That's gone on the digital test, but the digital test does have an annotation tool. So I'm going to pop a link into the chat for the digital AP exams in 2023. I did a review of this on our TikTok as well. When you look at the software, and by the way, you can download that Blue Book software tonight. You can get used to expanding the passage, zooming in. You can use process of elimination. You can highlight and annotate all through the text. So this is a theme. Somebody wrote in the chat like, bro, thank you. I was overthinking. Is Frankenstein a good choice? Yes.
Yes, always.
Y'all are overthinking everything. You can do this. And go ahead, actually, Heather, and you can unshare your screen with these slides. And we can kind of close with a couple of ideas and tips. The first is y'all are smarter and better and more destined for success than you realize. That's one. Two, the kinds of like, I'm gonna run to Reddit and freak out tonight and comment on TikToks, don't. right? Just as Heather was saying, get in your PJs, take care of yourself. The most important thing you're going to do tomorrow is have a great test day. Even though it's awful and kind of nerve-wracking, you're going to get in the zone and you're going to make sure on multiple choice, you don't let one question hog up 5 minutes. You're going to make sure that when you go through the essays, you're the CEO of the clock. You're owning that time. Don't lie to yourself. Be like, the proctor never said anything. Bro, you spent an hour and 31 minutes on one essay. You can't do that.
Don't do that.
40, maybe 41 or 2 minutes, move on. And really just focus on execution. And find the final thing I'll say before I turn it over to Heather, who I'll give you the final word is, on the AP exam, you do not, any AP exam, you don't need 100%. You don't need 90%. You don't need 80. You need 71.5%. You need a C minus to get a 5, right? So, and you're going through the essays and you're thinking, oh, I'm not getting the sophistication point. You don't need that for that for the 5 either. Lower the bar to the bar that you can hit. I got a 5 on the AP English Literature exam, and I know I got a bunch of multiple choice questions wrong. I know I didn't get perfect scores in those essays. I just did the best that I could do. I was exhausted. I walked out of the test with like stars in my eyes, like spinning around. And that's how I survived. So Heather, you've been doing this for almost 20 years with students. What is the final kind of advice you want to give students as they head into the exam?
I need you to trust yourself. I need you to trust your educational experience, trust in the books that you've read, and just go in and do the best version that you can give. If you are still testing and 10 people around you are done, ignore them and keep going, right? You, like John just said, you are the CEO of your test. Own it and just do the best you can do. You're gonna be great.
That's how it goes. So everyone, as we wrap up, I wanna see the chat filled with emojis of joy and optimism and manifesting fives with candles or whatever Gen Z does. You know, these kids, they got crystals, they got little candles. Yep. It's some kind of witchcraft going on. We want the witchcraft of 8.5 hours of sleep and you taking care of yourself. And breakfast, witchcraft of breakfast, 3 square meals a day and hydration. If you like this video, press that like button, stick around with us at Marco Learning. We're going to be going live in a whole bunch of other subjects and our free events page, which I'm going to pop into the chat here for you. We have live reviews in a whole bunch of other subjects. In fact, we got to get off the stream because we got another live review tonight. What's today? May the 2nd. Let's just look it up here. We've got Tom Ritchie for AP European History on our, on AP European History on our channel. Tom is going live on his channel right now. So check this out on the marcolearning.com/free event, free-events page. Take care of yourselves. Good luck, everyone, and have a great test.
Good night, guys.